Good morning. Welcome you all to this unique event that we are trying to put together. As you, the format of this event is just a few commercial break by me, we'll talk a little bit about Indic Academy. Then we'll have the moderator, I've requested Sanjeev to open the discussion with his comments. And then we'll have the author, Jerry, to talk about his book. And once he does that, the moderator will go around to all the panelists, seeking their views and comments on the book. And then we'll give time back to Jerry so that he can respond to the specific comments that all the panelists have made. And then the moderator will open it as a free-for-all discussion. So that's the format that we adopted. So brief about, first of all, thank you very much for coming. Sunday morning, 10 o'clock, organizing, a lot of people have complained, rightfully so. So very warm welcome to all of you who have agreed. I've been after you to read the book and this new format of discussing important books rather than just doing it as a launch, but reading it and having an intimate discussion. It's more about discussing the ideas. And this is such a very important book that has come at the right time. And it's been written by an entrepreneur, so that's something which I like, being an entrepreneur myself. Just a brief background, my relationship with Jerry started 30 years back. He doesn't know. I qualified as a CA and started my practice. And then my first assignment as a chartered accountant, practicing chartered accountant, was with Citibank. Citibank, he was the rock star CEO at that time, and he's completely revolutionized consumer financing. So they had this concept of hiring chartered accountants in each city to do their vetting of the documentation. So I was one of the chartered accountants to do it for Hyderabad. And that was my first exposure. This was way back in 89-90, Jerry, that famous offsite you did in Fisherman's Cove, and they had a special hotline so that you could communicate, all that. But he was a rock star at the time. But the things that I learned at that time, I just want to share, and how that 30 year back imprint, that the kind of innovation that he brought about at that time is now having the seeds of thought in what Indic Academy is doing. It's basically the concept of scale. How do you think of scale? Because Citibank had only four branches and you want to get into consumer financing. And the way he thought about scale and reaching out, loan mailers, reaching out to dealers and giving them financing to reach out to consumers. My first assignment with Citibank was with APSRTC, where they financed APSRTC, and I had to go and collect all the things, all the branches. So it's a very interesting experience, Jerry. And the reason I'm bringing this up now, I met you in 89 at Amlok Singh at that time. He didn't know about it till now. The reason why I bring this up is that the thing to do now is about think about scale. And what at Indic Academy, what we're trying to do is, how do we implement narrative, how to implement change, how to implement ideas, and think about everything from a scale point of view, because that's the only way we can make an impact. And so all our initiatives so far, we always think about how does this idea translate and make an impact globally and across the country. So thank you very much for those lessons, Jerry, 30 years back. You can see that in what we are doing. And do you know any iconic dialogues in Hindi movies? Any iconic dialogue? Right, that's it. But you know what's the iconic dialogue for today, in these days? Give me 30 seconds. That's by my good friend Anand, and he says, just give me 30 seconds, and the whole world shakes. The whole liberal world shakes when he says, give me 30 seconds. That's the iconic moment. And we have now a ritual and a tradition of opening up our events through Mysore Park. And I request you to please, Anand.
Mysore Park is
there is a debate always about whether it's, you know, Mysore and Tamil Nadu and all that. But I want to tell you the best Mysore Paks are from Andhra, the promoters are Andhra. So I just want to. So please come.
There's also a school of thought, it's from Pakistan.
Best Mysore Pak is from Baswanpur.
Guardian knot, yes.
All right.
So that's the first piece for him.
No, first piece for you. All right. I should take half of this.
Yes.
Plus, it's too big.
Thank you very much. With that,
Hari.
If you can be on a diet, then I can also be on a diet.
Thank you very much. So with that, I now hand over the proceedings to Sanjeev.
Thank you, Hari. I'm going to keep my comments very, very short because I think we should get it quickly into first Jerry's own thoughts, as he's the author, and then all yours. I think this is an interesting thing, both the Indic Academy experiment as well as this book, that after maybe you know, two generations, if not three, the India's right or India's conservative group has begun to generate material of it, of new intellectual inquiry, whether it's books, articles, debates, seminars, and so on. So literally in the last 5-6 years, this is still a very new experience after a very, very long hiatus. So this is in some ways an interesting point in time of which we are now partaking. And this book about the Indian conservative is a great contribution to that debate. And in some ways, it then goes back and links through one to how Indian thought itself connects through to the wider conservative movement, so to say, of intellectual movement globally, and also, of course, what are the elements within Indian conservatism. Of course, as you all know, the term itself is not without its detractors. What do you mean by conservative? For example, one could make the argument that when you use the word conservative vis-a-vis the term liberal, what you are talking about is somebody who's conservative who wants to not necessarily perpetuate, but certainly is in favor of the existing power equations and institutions in a system. And even if they want change, they want to do that change in a more incremental way, as opposed to liberal who may want a more open system. But again, right up front, you'll have a problem with it. So, for example, in China, is a conservative from the right? Because one could argue that a conservative in China would be a communist apatchik. In Kolkata, a conservative is usually has these almost Naxalite left-wing views of the Bhadralok, whereas the younger sort of radicals, so to speak, tend to be much more from the right. So, in that context, the conservative is actually completely different from what this term is usually used for. Then the question then is if the then for the country as a whole, who are the conservatives? Is, I would argue that the Nehruvian Khan market elite is the conservatives, because they want the perpetuation of the India intellectual center power equations. So if that is not, then if that is the way to think about it, then the opposite of conservative is not liberal but radical, i.e. those who are questioning that power equation. So in that, using that logic, the sort of Prime Minister Modi and those who support him would be considered radicals opposing the conservatives, and those who call themselves the liberals are actually the conservatives. Now, okay, if that is not the way to think about it, then should we think about it in terms of right wing and left wing? That is another way of cutting this cake. There also you very quickly come into all kinds of problems. For example, the right or the left, for that matter, are labels that are quite complicated. The right includes the economic right, the cultural right. There may be some intersection, but very often they disagree with each other. Then there is the libertarian right, there's the free market right, there's the mercantilist right, just on the economic side, by the way. And then on the cultural side, there can be many combinations thereof. Even on the left, you have all kinds of combinations. You have the Fabian Nehruvian type left, there's the communist Marxist kind of left. It turns out the feminists on the left, but so are the Islamists. So you have a bizarre situation where you have the Islamists and the feminists sitting on the same part of the ideological spectrum. Worldwide, not just in India, and you have seen the contradictions of that happening in the recent CAA protests. So again, you can see that these labels can be very, very quickly, very complicated. Then even if you manage to agree on certain parameters, they then change from context to context. For example, abortion and gay rights are issues of a certain kind in the American debate on right and between the right and the left, or the liberals and the conservatives, whichever you like it. It's not in India. So you have the ironical situation that it's in India where it is in under a right-wing government and environment where many of these things like gay rights, etc., haven't gotten mainstreamed, whereas it was the allies of the left, including the Islamists, but also various evangelical Christian groups and so on, who opposed this. So the point is, these labels tend to be very, very complicated very, very quickly. And certainly in the Indian context, they can be even more messy. Nonetheless, I think labels are useful because they are a shorthand for getting a debate going. And in the Indian context, these debates have happened for a very, very long time. For example, and I have written about this extensively, there was a debate, for example, between in the very early texts between Brihaspati and Shukra. They were both rishis, and they all belonged to two different schools of thought. Brihaspati, who was called the guru of the devas, and Shukra, who was the guru of the asuras. And by the way, in early Indian thought, the devas and the asuras are not good and bad, as we have ended up being in later times. And Shukra is very much of the school. I mean, you have to remember what is the nature of political thought in India. Starts with the one, trying to solve the one problem, which is the problem of Matsya Nyaya, which is the law of the fish, where the big fish eats the small fish. And Shukra's view was that the way to end Matsya Nyaya was largely by focusing on Dandaniti, or the rule of law. So he was very much a legalist in the way he thinks about the whole issue of how to end Matsya Nyaya. He's a very severe legalist. And then you have Brihaspati, who has a softer view. Yes, he thinks that Dandaniti is important, but he also thinks policy is important. Now, many, many generations later, we don't know exactly what, by Mauryan times, these now translate into the debate between Chanakya. Chanakya, again, is about a strong but limited state. He wants a strong state. He has no sense of humor about what the Indian state should do when it comes to the things it should do. But at the same time, Chanakya is extremely suspicious of the government official. So he says that, you know, just like it is impossible to tell how much water a fish drinks, it is impossible to tell how much money a government official is skimming. So you have a very interesting situation where the limits of the state, which in Western thinking is limited by ideas of freedom, in Indian thinking, it is the limitations on the state are put forward on grounds of rent seeking and corruption. So that is the Chanakyan view. Now, two generations later comes along Ashoka, and he has a much more paternalistic view of what, an almost patronizing view of what the state should do. So he goes and talks about how, you know, the Indian state should extend itself to, you know, he has all these strictures on when, you know, you should eat meat on this and this date, and the bull should be castrated on, not be castrated on the third day of Tissa and the fourth day of something, Chaturmasi and so on. And he tends to have this opinion that the bull really cares on which day his balls get chopped off. But this is the kind of approach that Ashoka takes, very much interfering. But at the same time, he's arguing for a much weaker state. He argues for Dharma Mahamantas. Now, the modern translate of that is religious police. So this benign view of Ashoka that we have come to imbibe in the 20th century does not at all come through in his own inscriptions. And one could make a case for a very tyrannical, interfering monarch from the same text that are used and inscriptions that are used usually to make the case for him being a benign, peace-loving emperor. So my view is very often the ideological stances are not merely embedded in what these people are saying, but also in the way we interpret the person who's reading it. Many often what you read is very much comes from the frame of reference that you take. So before I just hand it over to Jerry, I would just say that these are streams of thought that have been there in India for a very long time. Of course, in the 19th and early 20th century, many of these things came to the fore in India in terms of debates that the Indians were having among themselves, as well as reacting to the new thoughts and ideas and debates that were happening in the rest of the world. But then, in some ways, this debate ended in the 1950s, in a sense, because essentially the sort of with the Swatantra Party and so on was kind of, in a sense, the last sort of round where there was an intellectual effort to make a case for the conservatives or the right in India. And then it dies out. So it's not as if there is, nobody remembers that period of thought, but effectively the left won both the political and intellectual debate. And for half a century, there was almost no debate. 1991, when India began to open up its economy, it didn't happen because of a change in intellectual discourse. It happened because our economy collapsed and we were forced to open up. There was, even at that time, if those of you, most of you are old enough to remember that period, the intellectuals of that time were still making the case for the continuation of the previous regime. So it was not a change of heart that led to 1991. It was simply economic and geopolitical circumstances that changed it. The Indian intellectual establishment remained completely loyal to the left worldview. And it is only relatively recently that, I would say less than a decade, that this new way of thinking has been revived. We have, and what Jerry and others are doing, and I'm glad I have here Hindol as well, who has been very much a part of this debate, and many of the rest of you as well, who have begun to dig into our intellectual past and find out streams of thought that were in some ways either buried over or subverted in many ways. And so with that, let me hand it over to Jerry.
Thank you, Sanjeev. Thank you, Hari, for organizing this, and thank you all distinguished panelists for agreeing to come. Let me kind of quickly tell you how this book came about. We were talking earlier, a couple of us, about the intellectual thraldom in which our universities exist. And I'm one of the original founding supporters of Ashoka University. So one day I got into an argument with Rudrangshu, the chancellor there, saying, you know, this is absurd. You guys have become turned it into a leftist den. We don't have, your students are not exposed to any counter-narrative, which of course I believe is a correct counter-narrative, among other things. So he said, why don't you come and speak to them? So I did a series of lectures in Ashoka, not very reasonably sparsely attended, but there was some interest, some sparks of interest, and some students, in fact, a couple of them came and saw me in the room in the guest house and said, we are scared to tell people that we, you know, we are pro-right-wing or we are proud of being Hindus or whatever. So they had to come sneak into my room in the evening to share these kinds of ideas. That is how oppressive the atmosphere. And of course, as we know, it's not just in Indian universities, it is true in American and European universities too. London School of Economics, my daughter was doing a master's there. An Israeli technocrat, engineer alumnus, entrepreneur came to speak, and they didn't let him speak in London School of Economics. He was an alumnus, and he was going to speak on technology and entrepreneurship. So they had to do it somewhere else in a Jewish Students Association. And my daughter, of course, being so violently pro-Zionist, she turned up there, and then they were scared. Hey, what is this dark girl coming? What is this all about? Is she a bomb-throwing person kind of thing? So, I mean, this is, so the oppression in the Anglo-American and European university world is a major thing. I mean, they do not teach them anything about Burke or Hume, or, of course, Adam Smith is taught, one sentence of Adam Smith is taught in economics departments, and that's about it. Certainly our own classics are completely ignored. Foucault and Derrida and all these bogus charlatans are the ones that get all the attention. And then therefore you have generation on generation of PhD scholars coming out brainwashed in that episteme. Since that series of lectures ended up becoming this book. When I started, of course, we all start with Burke. So I started with Burke and Smith and spent some time on the Scottish Enlightenment and so on. But it seemed to me that this is not just an imported intellectual conceit. Matsyanaya that he was talking about is the thing that horrifies our ancients the most. Whenever they mention Matsyanaya, you can almost see the hair on their skin standing up. They're so, scared, so kind of upset with this concept. It's a repeat motif in the Shanti Parva of the Mahabharata, in the Tirukkural. As I was kind of going through this, maybe it's accident, maybe it's that's the way human synchronicity exists. But I was able to see the parallels between Scottish Enlightenment, English conservatism, and our own texts. I think there are three particular ones that I've made lots of reference to, Shanti Parva and Tirukkural, which I consider as foundational texts of our civilization and culture. And Apastamba Sutra of the Yajurveda. Because there, the concept of Yoga Dharma is first enunciated. And to my mind, Yoga Dharma is what Burke talks about again and again. we need to change in order to conserve. The idea that every yuga has to have a slightly different, certain things are constant, but certain things change. And that change is necessary in order to conserve what is best. It's a very Burkean and Disraeli idea. But that is there in the Apasama Sutra, that every age will have its yuga dharma, which is necessary in order to prevent the occurrence of Matsya Nyaya in that age. Sometimes it might be Danda, sometimes Sama, Bheda, it doesn't matter, but or a combination thereof, but the yoga dharma does change. Then when I was exploring this in more recent times, what occurred to me was one reason, apart from the fact that the Stalinists won the debates of the 50s and 60s and 70s, both by using political patronage and by sheer numbers and by denying intellectual respectability to their opponents. The other issue was that by simply labeling anybody who had been even slightly pro the British Raj as a traitor, as a comprador, the entire pre-independent set of conservatives became traitors. Tej Bahadur Sapru, who as recently as the 1930s was talking about dominion status, whereas by 29 the Congress was already talking about Purna Swaraj, is therefore a traitor. Rajagopalachari, who opposed the Quit India movement, is a traitor. A Shyam Prasad Mukherjee, who said that we will fight the Japanese, is a traitor. But this guy, I don't know why everyone's fascinated with this guy, who shook hands with Hitler and Tojo and Mussolini, he is a great patriot. So this complete dislike of the Raj has created a way of simply ignoring the conservative element in our intellectual. So I have argued that, you know, the Raj had its faults. Nobody says it was perfect. But there's a quotation there which actually I picked up from Swapan's book, which is from Bhandarkar's 1895 speech to the Indian Social Congress, where, you know, basically the Bhandarkar was a patriot. This business that anybody who was slightly well disposed towards the Raj is not a patriot is ridiculous. You know, Ambedkar was in the Viceroy's Executive Council right through the Second World War. Does that make him not a patriot? I mean, Bhandarkar talks about, and I consider that the high watermark of 19th century, early 20th century Indian conservatism. So anyway, there are two strands going, as always, as we in modern India, most of these go back to Bengal and go back to the mid-19th century. There is Ram Mohan Roy, who I believe is the father of Burkean conservatism in India. He basically told the visiting French aristocrat that he wanted English rule, British rule to continue in India for a long time so that we could learn more from them. So he was a supporter of British rule. Bankim, from the other school strand, the Hindu nationalist strand, virtually the father of it, he too wanted British rule because he thought it was providential that British rule was actually saving us from Islamic depredations and enabling a renaissance among the Hindus. That's how he ends Anand Math. So these two strands are there, and they are in parallel. They overlap sometimes. You can call them siblings. And I've argued that they are both very intellectually respectable and important strands. To dismiss either of them or both of them and simply live with this leftist, penumbra is doing a great disfavor to our students and to ourselves as citizens of this country. I've divided it into five sections. The economic is where basically Shenoy and the Bombay school were driven out of Delhi, and Malanubis and Sukhumoy Chakravarti and K.N. Raj and all these bogus fellows completely took over. And the consequence, I mean, it was immoral. I mean, leftism is immoral, but more importantly, consequentially, it is disastrous. The consequence is everyone became rich, we remained poor. And I think, frankly, it was the economists who, from a consequentialist, not from a moral perspective, became the first critics of socialism. Bhagwati, Srinivasan, even Manmohan Singh, basically said, hey, wait a minute, you know, this is not working. So it was a consequentialist criticism. The earlier criticism of Shenoy was consequentialist, but Rajagopalachari and Masani was moral. Masani is very interesting. He started as a socialist. He's a little bit like Arthur Kessler, the god that died kind of thing. He changed, like Stephen Spender. He changed from being one of those to becoming one of us. And therefore, he could see the follies of Stalinism, gigantism, this public sector, this not only for consequential reasons, but for moral reasons, because it would completely destroy liberties, which is what happened. Pandit Nehru kept arguing that the Supreme Court, by defending property rights, defending zamindars and maharajas and tatas and birlas, they abolished property as a fundamental right. Who benefited? I think Mr. Ratan Tata got free land from the communist government of West Bengal, taking it away from peasants, and who suffered? The peasants. And this had been predicted. Both Rajagopalachari and Masani had predicted that if you take away property rights, the final sufferers will be the poor. So on the economics, we lost it, but luckily, because of geopolitical, the Berlin Wall fell, Gorbachev came on the scene, communism got discredited, Reagan and Thatcher won the war. So we had several bright economists who started, but all still consequentialists. My argument here is that we don't accept Lal, who I would say is a moral philosopher in the Adam Smith tradition. We still don't have a moral position on this. Remember, he wrote Theory of Moral Sentiments 15 years before he wrote Wealth of Nations. So Smith started as a moral philosopher, and the impartial spectator through who looks at all of us, each of us imagines an impartial spectator looking at us, is a very Smithian idea, very similar to Mahatma Gandhi's still small inner voice of conscience. On the cultural side, the real issue has been the Orientalist paradigm that there is no India, it's purely a, you know, before the Regulating Act of 1778, 72, before that, the governors of Madras and Bombay reported directly to Leadenhall Street in London. And if that had continued, maybe we would have been three colonies or three countries. 1772, according to the British, is the creation of India. And in an administrative sense, they may be right. The governor of Bengal became the governor general, and then after that, there was one common Indian government, etc. But I've argued very strongly that that is the idea of India has been imagined a long time ago. It's a cultural idea, it's a sacred geography idea, and it is not new. Again, they don't prescribe. Radha Kumud Mukherjee has a brilliant essay on this. Not prescribed. You only read all these Ayesha Jalals and all these absurd people. You don't read the great doyens of Indian history. And I've argued very strongly that this is, again, by using these words, Hindu, this, that, and the other, you fall into the Orientalist trap. They use these words for us. I don't care what word you use, but if you want to know, as a matter of fact, not only is there a great pilgrimage circuit for those of us who believe in Shiva and Vishnu and Shakti and so on, but there is a Sufi pilgrimage circuit which is entirely within India, from Delhi, through Ajmer, through Ahmedabad, through Bombay, through Gulbarga, all the way south through Nagaur, near Tanjore, back through Kadapa, and so on. So, and this, by the way, this Sufi pilgrimage circuit doesn't exist in any other country. So this idea of the land as sacred and imagining it this way, this Bharatavarsha idea, is very, very much there, and it didn't start in 1772. The Indian culture, and it has been dismissed. It is dismissed routinely in all Anglo-American universities today who have, by the way, we have outsourced, and I have argued in the section of education, we've outsourced even Indology studies to American universities. You know, forget about outsourcing civil engineering or geology. Even Telugu literature You know, we have outsourced there. So we've kind of given up on so much by not investing in our educational systems. The political one is the tough one. Political one is a tough one because everybody has a point of view there. And my view is that it all hinges around the Raj. If you accept that in fact the period 1745, we trace it in southern India, the Battle of Santhome, or 1799, fall of Seringapatam, to about 1950, if you trace that as the period of a couple of hundred years, it's actually a very, very creative period in Indian history. It's not a you know, simply to be dismissed as a dark age. Not only did we have Ram Mohan Roy, we had Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, we had Vivekananda, we had Ramalinga Vadalar, we had Ramana Maharishi, we had Aurobindo. So we had enormous intellectual activity, enormous writing, Radhakrishnan, Hiriyanna, S. N. Das Gupta in philosophy, Parasnis, Kincaid, Jadunath Sarkar, Nilakantha Shastri in history. So we actually, it was a very creative period. And we came up with some very important ways of looking at it. It is unfortunate that two things. One, Gandhi moved it towards mass movement, which was probably necessary. But he stuck to Gokhale on one thing. He did not believe in violence. Unlike Gokhale, he did not believe in committees and representations in triplicate and quadruplicate and discussions and debates. That was the original conservative way of dealing with political matters. Gandhi believed in mass action and hartals. Shankaran Nayan warned him that could lead to anarchy in days to come. And today, that might be one of Gandhi's dubious gifts to our country, the street protests and anarchy. But otherwise, he was relatively benign because he was not committed. He was committed to nonviolence. And his only one acolyte who was committed to violence, he kicked him out of the party. So, because this is important. I mean, I think, again, modern conservatism, Burke's objection to the French Revolution was that it was discarding the best of the past. It was also being violent. And in that process, you will lose a lot of good things when you do violent stuff. I've argued that the real revolutionary year is actually Jinnah. Because from 1772, even if you accept the British Orientalist argument, gradually the country was getting united. To break it, that is an act of violence. That is a revolutionary act. It's not an evolutionary act. It's not a constitutional act. And I think the consequences of that, I have recommended to Pakistani intellectuals that they should read Burke on the French Revolution. They might understand their rather tragic history post-1947 if they go back and read Burke. Ours has been, Swaminathan Iyer wrote to me saying, you are going on the wrong thing. You are talking that the Indian Constitution is conservative. It's not. It's a completely radical document. How can you do that? So then I almost abandoned the book. And then I went back and did some more research and so on. The process is conservative. There is a continuous development from Regulating Act, Petty India Act, Charter Acts, Queen's Proclamation, Minto Mauli reforms, Montague Kempfert reforms, Government of India Act of 1935. There is a continuous evolutionary part to the evolution of the Indian Constitution. It is not a document written in Bastille on one day. It is an evolved document. In fact, 60% of the Constitution is a repeat of the Government of India Act of 1935. So I am arguing that, in fact, the emergence of the Republic of India was a part of a conservative process. And that is why it has been relatively successful. And in fact, for the first 3 years, 47 to 50, till the constitution was adopted, it was a very conservative group. Rajagopalachari was Governor General, Rajendra Prasad was President of the Constituent Assembly, Ambedkar was a constitutionalist and was the chairman of the drafting committee. K. Munshi was active there. So it was not, there's no element of the Petrograd Soviet in the Indian constitution, despite the influence that the Soviets had. It's been a pretty rough time period through the 60s and 70s, and I think the Jansang, and I've spent a little bit of time looking at it, basically became a Hindi party after Shyam Prasad's death and kind of lost national salience. The Swatantra emerged and actually did pretty well, but it was like one of those meteors that come and go and disappeared, and it's never had a life back again. Its opponent, very clever pundit from Allahabad, managed to describe the Swatantra Party as a Maharaja Tata Birla Party. And he managed to marginalize them, and his daughter, of course, by getting rid of privy purses and introducing MRTP and so on, she made sure that Tata Birla, Dalmia, and the Maharajas became unable or unwilling to support the Swatantra. So that party disappeared. How did this come back? I mean, again, as a predicting man, in 1977 or 1980, you might not, or certainly in 1984 when Rajiv Gandhi swept the polls, you might not have predicted the Hindu nationalism will have a comeback. But I think the reason it's had a comeback is it's been faithful to certain ideas of Bankim and Lajpat Rai. The idea is consolidation across castes, across groups, to create a band of brothers. Band of brothers is a Shakespeare expression from Henry V, Battle of Agincourt. That band of brothers feeling is what, and in fact, the first party in the country to have an OBC as prime minister is the Hindu Nationalist Party. The first party to kind of embrace the entire caste spectrum. I mean, it's interesting, the Communist Party of India till D. Raja now is the first Dalit to get any high position. It's always been a Brahmin, Bhadralok party, Rana Dive Joshi, etc. It's always been an upper caste party, as is the Congress. So the BJP has been able to do this. And I think in doing this, they have been able to move beyond the Hindi heartland. It seems to be a work in progress, which is, it. And I have made, I think, 1.5 paragraphs mention of the most recent Red Fort speech. Most recent speech, I think, of Parliament after the 2019 election, where Modi refers to 1857. And in 1857, if you go back to Savarkar, the early Savarkar, not the later Savarkar, the early Savarkar, he talks about 1857 as being a band of brothers moment for both Hindus and Muslims. Is that what Modi is trying to do? We don't know. Time will tell. Why the reference to 1857 all of a sudden in that speech? And what is a band of brothers movement going forward going to look like? We don't know. But there is a danger. There are extreme violent elements within the Hindu nationalist, and I've made the reference to Bhasmasura. Bhasmasura is this mythical character who has a magical power to put his hand and burn anything below him. If eventually, as luck would have it, he puts his hand over his head and burns himself. That there is this danger, and Burke has pointed this out way back in 1790, that violence can lead to self-destruction. So that danger is there. But I think it's exaggerated by the opponents. That danger is there in every movement. You can't judge Russian nationalism based on pathological extreme Slavophiles or Germany based only on Nazi period. You have to have a kind of pathological extremism is possible, but it's not a given that it will happen. I don't think Swatantra can be revived, but I think those who believe in Swatantra ideas can and should try and influence caucuses within the BJP, within the Congress, within the DMK, within each of the existing parties to move them in the direction that we would like them to move. This is a, Rajni Kothari had brought this up in the 50s and 60s. He had called it the strategy of having a caucus, like K.M. Munshi would be part of the Hindu caucus within the Congress party. Krishna Menon was the part of the Communist caucus. So you tried to maneuver by planting your people within the Congress. And I think those who believe in markets and liberal libertarian ideas would do well to imitate Rajni Kothari's caucus strategy. The sections in social aesthetic have been are also quite interesting. I'm relatively optimistic on social. I'm optimistic on social because we continue to pay attention to the wisdom of the swain, the peasants. That's very important for Burke. You know, one of the reasons these guys are losing in England and America is that the left has stopped paying attention to the wisdom of the peasants. And the peasants, according to Burke, have far more wisdom than coffeehouse-based intellectuals or self-appointed intellectuals. And so I think we are very, very vigorously moving the way this is both on the this is in every way, you know, be it on caste. You mentioned about gender issues. We don't need to worry about it. There is a temple called the Aravan Temple near Virupuram, where every year all the transvestites get together, transgenders get together to do a puja. So you know we have it within our traditions. We don't need to worry about these matters. I think social, and even those elements in our society which have been relatively rigid, like Muslims, I am quite optimistic. In my book, I mentioned the fact that Muslim women have taken the lead in entry into Haji Ali Dargah. There is a Pasmanda or OBC Muslim movement in Bihar, where essentially they're acknowledging that they are lower caste converts, which is what the RSS would like them to acknowledge, that they are converts. So it's a kind of a interesting way that these two ideas are coming together. I am optimistic that I think the Disraeli dictum of changing while preserving the best in our tradition is happening on the social side. Aesthetic side also, I'm pretty optimistic because I think I've made a passing mention that All India Radio, even though it's a state institution, I compliment them because of them, Hindustani and Carnatic music have revived post-1947, and they are now very vigorous. We have created a whole new music form, which doesn't exist anywhere else in the world, called playback singing, where actors lip sync and run around trees, and songs come from behind. We have a vigorous cultural scene, aesthetic scene. Architecture, relatively disappointing, idiotic Chandigarh, dismal Gandhinagar, you know, terrible Navi Mumbai, ghostly Naya Raipur, moderately okay Bhubaneswar. But all our cities, Bhilai, Bokaro, Neyveli, impossible, they're all Stalinist colonies. It's just, we've not done a good job between PWD architecture, and our private sector's also let us down. Bangalore is full of steel and glass, or Singapore, nothing nice. I hope that will change. Lastly, I end with stuff on the environment. Conserve, Ram Guha pointed it out to me, that conservatism and conservation have the same root. And as Burke, by the way, Burke's speech, I strongly recommend his speech on the Prince of Arcot's debts in the House of Commons. He refers to, he praises Indian sovereigns of the past who built reservoirs and canals, not for their benefit, but for the benefit of future generations. So this idea that we have a Pitra Rana, a Rana to our ancestors, and a Rana or a debt to our descendants is very fundamental. We are not just operating outside, very fundamental to conservative thinking. And therefore, I think we need to be very active participants in the conservation movement. Again, going away from these binaries, either build a road or destroy a forest. I mean, as if there is no dialogue possible to get the best of both worlds. Other countries have done it. So it's not, I mean, Switzerland used to have landslides 150 years ago. They went back and rebuilt their forests. So it's possible. It's not that, you know, anything that's man-made can be fixed. So I've said conservatives should be at the forefront of this dialogue. Net-net, it's a bit of a manifesto. Net-net, it's a bit of a quick glance through what it is. It has some fairly acidic barbs against postmodernists, Marxists, leftists. It's deliberate, it's conscious, it's not accidental. I have made reference in the right at the end to the Matrokhin diaries and the Matrokhin YouTubes. I do believe our country was colonized in more ways than one by the KGB, and we are still paying a price for it. So I'm not that I don't kind of apologize for. Let me stop there and give it back to Sanjeev.
Thank you very much. What we're going to do is just ask a few people to, what we'll do is we'll get a few of you to respond to what Jerry just said, and many of you have read the book as well. And then we'll open it up for general discussion. So may I request you to keep your comments to be very, very short and pithy, so that there is more time left over for a wider discussion. With that, let me start with Sita. Can I ask you to start this?
Jerry simply loved the book, and especially the you know, hark back to the Indian conservative tradition going back to ancient times, because that is a problem that, you know, anyone on the right always has, that, you know, this is all a very Western import and all of that. Two things that sort of, you know, two questions I have really. One is about Masani, and, you know, you're calling him a moralist. You know, and you said that even now. But don't you see his transition from a socialist to this thing as being more of a consequential, you know, by your own definition, the book, of realizing that something, you know, the consequence of something is bad. Isn't he more of a consequentialist than a moralist? And secondly, this, you know, and again, I think Sanjeev referred to the change in 1991. And you referred to the pushback against, you know, central planning. Even that, isn't it more a consequentialist opposition? And given that, do you see that pushback sort of fading away? And, you know, a kind of a, will we have an Empire Strikes Back kind of a situation happening in some time? I think some of it is already happening, but I was wondering whether that could get more exaggerated.
Conrad, do you have some comments?
This one. So I was surprised, pleasantly surprised, to see how thorough your rootedness is in British conservatism. Rootedness itself being a typical conservative term. And so I'm not too impressed by the objection of many Twitter trolls tomorrow about, you see, oh, this is another import, and we have the answers. I mean, you see, this is a conceptual term, and you can find traces of it in many traditions, and you yourself have outlined some in Hindu traditions, in which, in particular, I appreciate your revaluation of the Shanti Parva, which is there in your book, along with the Tirukural, as like foundational texts of Hindu civilization. I also need to remark that Sitaram Goel, the historian who had a sort of love-hate relationship with the Hindutva movement, was himself in 1957 a candidate of the Swatantra Party. And so in his anti-communist activities, there is a strong streak of that conservative tradition differing from the Hindutva movement in India, which at that time was moving closer and closer to socialism, in fact. So yeah, I mean, it's really time to come into our own, so to speak, and to shift a bit the emphasis from the typical nationalist Hindutva themes to a more contents-oriented political movement. I applaud that. I mean, maybe later today we'll come into more detailed points, but I'm all for it.
Anand, do you have some comment?
Hi, thanks very much. I really congratulate you for this book. I found it very engaging. And I looked at the blurb, and can I just say this is perhaps the only time Shekhar Gupta has been correct. But I have a couple of points to make. One is, as Sanjeev also pointed out, and in fact, indeed, as is the running theme thread in your book as well, you have also pointed out that you know, conservative, being a conservative is quite ambiguous. You know, many times I have found that the real people whom we call conservative are actually the true liberals. So in that sense, I found the overarching theme or indeed the title of the book quite ambiguous and could be misleading. That is, you're calling people conservative who actually are not conservative. So here I would like to make a couple of points, and being from the domain of science, I actually am not a fan of the whole word, the word and the phrase conservative, because it is antithetical to Darwinian theory of evolution. And if you look at, even if you were to extrapolate that Darwin's theory to how societies work, you know, mutation, mixing, diversity is at the heart of adaptation and survival. And to conserve simply means that you actually, you have some sort of opposition to change, which ironically you say it is not truly the running thread. As I said, you know, many of the themes that I'm bringing out right now, you've already addressed. And also, I think conservatism is, I would say, the juice of defensive, and it's the juice of social Darwinism. And two threads that run, one is that we've already achieved, we want to conserve some things because we believe they're perfect, and the other is survival of the fittest. And if you look at, for example, some of the heroes of conservatives, I mean, Churchill comes to mind immediately. You know, he was absolutely delighted of the way Britain had, you know, kind of killed and maimed millions of people around the world. He was absolutely unapologetic about the annihilation of, you know, various populations. Tasmania comes to mind. And secondly, if you look at Gandhi, who I consider conservative, I mean, he was proud to advocate the preservation of caste system, hereditary caste system. So these are a couple of things, and of course, if I may say so, Jerry, I do find that there's absolutely nothing wrong in being an Anglophile, you know, aesthetically as well and everything. But I did find at many places Raj apologia running through the book. Especially, I would like you to counter this thing that you've said that I found quite problematic, that the Raj and the Maharajas who did not allow the plebs to hunt have actually led to preservation of, you know, species and forests. I would have thought that the tigers nearly became extinct because of the, you know, mad hunting by the Maharajas. So I would say that it's a beautiful and very engaging book, but the title itself kind of puts a label on the very people who I believe are not conservative. I mean, if you were to go on, you know, if you were to define Hinduism as religion, let us say, which I think it's an offshoot of a way of life, Hinduism, whereas in Islam, the way of life is the offshoot of religion. I would say the real conservatives are people who follow, you know, Abrahamic religions. And it's even becoming less so amongst the Christians, but amongst the Muslims, it is absolutely. And the only ones who try and, you know, kind of move away from conservative Islam or fundamental Islam are the bad Muslims who do not believe or who are kind of, who shy away from accepting the word of Allah. So I think there's a lot of confusion there, which possibly the subsequent volumes or editions would clear up. Thank you.
Over to you.
This is the one.
Yeah. Jaithirth, first of all, congratulations on the book, and books like this are much needed because there is so little for people to go to when they're thinking of what is not left. You know, I'll just very briefly touch upon three challenges. Apart from, of course, having the challenge of having this round table being watched by Nehru and Indira there. One is, of course, the whole definition. We are still grappling with whether we call broadly what we represent as right or conservative. What do we call that? I mean, because everywhere you go back to the whole Western definition of it, and if you say this is conservative, then where do we stand on LGBT, for instance, LGBTQIA? A lot of people on the ground, a lot of Indians actually are a lot more Indian LGBT people are a lot more comfortable within the Indic fold than under left or, you know, in the left ideology. Or, for instance, how would, you know, where is the economic consensus? I mean, what kind of a RSS's own BMS? Or, you know, there's a very, yeah, Swadeshi, the whole thought about of protectionism, Swadeshi, etc. And on one hand, you have the whole free market thoughts. So there, these contradictions, that's a huge challenge in properly defining. And also where, you know, I agree with Sanjeev and Anand both, that, you know, a lot of what is happening is radical rather than conservative. So that is one challenge. The other challenge is to exactly define, or not define actually. We shouldn't try to define, then we would be actually putting a lot of people outside we should try and have a consensus probably on what are absolutely essential traits of, for the lack of a better word, right or conservative. So what are, where do we, a very strong economy, a strong, militarily strong India, culturally. So this whole thing of a consensus, now that we are talking about it, books like yours, you know, give us the occasion to talk about it, that is one. And finally, the challenge of intellectually there being so little material to go back to. Again, I come back to that point, and this government has done incredibly politically, one would say, risky things in the last 6 years, absolutely defining changes. But one thing it has not done is anything about education. One of the ministers goes on record saying he is proud that he has not changed, the education minister says that he is not proud that he has not changed a single word in the syllabus. I'm not wrong, no? And nothing has been done. So the CA protests, a lot of urban youngsters, for them, they, you know, this whole brainwash, they find that this is the CA protests is all about being liberal, etc., etc. They do not have any book or any culture on the right to go back to. There's a complete shortage of those resources. In fact, I was a little alarmed when my son, 16, he's reading Jordan Peterson, etc., etc., but you know, he also mentioned Milo. And so in India, these, which is why your book is important, and it also gives us a lot of resources, talks about a lot of resources which we can go back to. But for instance, Thirukkural, is there an English translation?
Is it?
Okay. So I'm saying, I mean, if these could... if these could be brought to the mainstream of knowledge, that's all I mean.
Nobody has heard of him. Yeah. And yet Manucharitamo is a very central work of modernity. It is a work of modernity. 500 years old. Manucharitamo.
I don't even know about it.
Allah Sami Peddana was a court poet at Krishnadevaraya's court. There's half a page on Krishnadevaraya and Vijayanagar Empire in NCRT textbooks. There's 25 pages on Mughal India. So therefore, we don't get this. Now, this is a recurring theme in our country. Markandeya Purana has the first reference to the first man and woman floating on a leaf at the end of the pralaya, when the great flood ends. The same haunting theme Allah Swami goes back to, but it's a Renaissance work actually. It's very comparable to, I would say, the best of Shakespeare and Marlowe in the way it treats the emergence of the modern human.
Yes, those are not
very much something. Luckily, in the
available in translation.
Yeah, Murti Siri Shulman, who's a great scholar, Israeli fellow, he has translated. It's available in the Murti series recently, and I've mentioned that at the back of my book. The incidentally, Jayashankar Prasad has done it in Hindi. It's called it Kamayani in the 20th century. So this first man floating on a leaf seems to be a recurrent theme across the country in multiple languages, Markandeya Purana, Telugu, Hindi, and these things don't go away. So it didn't start in 1772. this is an enduring theme in my book.
Hindul.
Thank you. I found your book really enlightening and very engaging. Thanks for writing it. I have a couple of questions. My first question is, when you define epistemologically the word conservative, and when we parallel it to other conservative movements around the world, we are faced with a bunch of challenges. I, for instance, do not consider myself either right-wing or conservative. I'm a liberal, but I'm a practicing Hindu. And therein, I think, lies the great difference, because I think many Hindus are not practicing Hindus. And I would like to argue, and I want to put this question to you, if Islamic politics can have an epistemological basis as Islamic politics, if Christian politics can have an epistemological basis as Christian politics without necessarily confining itself or resonating with either the conservative movement or the liberal movement, can Hindu politics be seen as Hindu politics without borrowing epistemologically from other broader socio-political movements? And I would like to argue, and I would like to ask you, if we could envisage a moment where Hindu politics is seen as such, as an independent realm on its own. As you know, Kanti Bajpai, when he spoke about, you know, six great ways of thinking about Indian grand strategy, he mentioned Hindu grand strategy as a minor school, so to speak, right? Now, my question is, can it graduate from a minor school to becoming a major school? And what is the process through which this transition takes place? That's my first question. My second question is about economics. It is, of course, true that if you read in detail many of the economic thinking of the RSS, including people like Thingdi and so on and so forth, you know, they were constantly looking for a middle path, so to speak. And, you know, in fact, the book is called The Third Way, right? And they're looking for a third way between this sort of socialist way of thinking and capitalism, right? Which, ironically, is something of great use today, because indeed, in the world, there is a conversation in economics which talks about whether extreme capitalism is not benefiting the world, and of course, extreme left-wing economics has not benefited the world. So the third way, I would argue that the moment for that third way is now, but it hasn't been, we have failed to give it voice, in a sense. And my third point, where you ended, is on environmentalism. I think Prime Minister Modi's great normative contribution, if there is one, is going to be in environmentalism. He's clearly making it very clear by the stances he's taking at the Paris Climate Change Agreement, including in popular culture by appearing in Bear Grylls' show and so on and so forth, right? And now there's a great waste to wealth movement that's coming up and so on and so forth. But how can we anchor that environmentalism into theory, or give it theoretical grounding today that can be applicable? So these are my three points that I would like to address. Thank you.
Thanks. May I move to Rahul?
Yeah. I will speak as someone who, with a great deal of honesty and a great deal of embarrassment, would say that I don't really, you know, I would need many right clicks on the book to understand some of the context. And that's where it actually becomes so important, because people like me need a sense of history, need a sense of identity. And there is so much lot to understand and study, which we skip during schools, because more than history, I was fascinated by trigonometry and calculus. So there is no sense of history. And when you, you know, during your youth, I'm still one, you start getting, associated or being identified with people who you discover have feet of clay, and you are no longer with them. You know, for example, I fancied myself as a right libertarian till 2015 or so, and now that's a sense of a loss of identity that I have. So in that sense, obviously, this book helps me, and it helps me, find a sense of history, a sense of belonging. But again, yeah, that's what everyone was saying, that's going to be a challenge, because it's the labels that we are struggling with, what to call ourselves. Ironically, this this is being organized by Indic Academy, and this is one term that we thought would be better than calling ourselves right-wing or conservative, that we are Indics. So that's almost everyone has said, and that's exactly where I think is most of the criticism is going to come to you, whether this label, whether we are force-fitting ourselves into something which is essentially and perhaps exclusively Western and doesn't fit into the Indian narrative. And in fact, on either of my side are seated, people who would remember Ram Mohan Roy, how a shitstorm was created on Twitter. And you have and you have put him along with Bankim yeah. Chatterjee as founders of Indian conservative movement, which within what we are putting as Indic or right wing is going to have some bit of a resistance. I don't know if you are on Twitter. Fortunately, perhaps you would be. Thankfully, you are not. Ah, that's great. Otherwise, you would have understood what I'm saying.
He's a real conservative.
So that's what I believe are going to be the challenges coming from. That for me, someone like me, yeah, it gives me a sense of history. It gives me a sense of identity. Currently, I'm happy being called Sanghi, even though I have never been to a Shakha. At least I now know that, who are the people, who are the what are the movements that I think I belong to. If I'm no more a libertarian, if I'm a lapsed libertarian. So these are the people, these are the identities. So in that sense, obviously, congratulations and thank you for the book. Most of the you know, criticism is going to come from, you know, mostly the labels, and whether we have appropriated some people whom we shouldn't have. And that's what mostly I would like to say, and thanks.
Thank you. Ranjanda?
Okay, so let me be contrarian to all the learned commentary we have heard. First of all, thank you, Jerry, for Jaithirth for
voice of the radical right,
putting together what I think is a fabulous book. I will just pick on some of the points which were discussed over here. I personally do not subscribe to this view that, oh, this is a Western concept, so we should steer clear. The West borrows a lot from the East and is increasingly borrowing a lot more from the East. So there is no reason why we should also not absorb what that is good in the West. Number two, I do not believe that, as a Bengali, I do not believe that the arrival of the British and subsequently the British Raj was a total disaster for this country. They have left behind great institutions, they have left behind great ideas, and in their own way, the empire also contributed to what we are today. Now, we begin with conflating terms, that conservative right, fundamentalists, fanatics. To be a conservative does not mean that you are not open to ideas. After all, even to conserve what you have or what you had, everything needs a certain amount of nurturing, nourishment, and has to be rethought of and recrafted to fit into the times that we live in. Hindutva was not a concept which was discovered by Savarkar. Dharmatattva precedes that. And if you go back to the original writings which were in Bengali and now find mention in footnotes of Asiatic Society papers, you will find that even at that point when they were being talked about, they were talking about the essence. So the essence remains the same, but the body and the shape sort of keeps on changing as time moves on. So to be a conservative is not, you know, if people laugh at you, let them laugh at you. I mean, you don't need to be bothered about that. A conservative I agree with Hindal. A conservative is essentially a classical liberal. What we see today posing as liberal, I mean, it's fraud of the lowest common denominator, because they have been able to sell an idea that this is what liberalism means, that you air kiss Faiz, but you think that Vande Mataram is communal. I will come to that in a point. If you allow me 2-3 minutes, please. I'm glad that this book talks about Ram Mohan Roy. A disclosure, I am a Brahmo, so I'm blind to him. But there are 3-4 strands that merit mention, and he mentioned it in his introductory remarks. That anybody who dealt with the British is to be derided. Anybody who did business with the British was to be derided. Carr and Tagore, the company which was formed to recycle salt, you know, the British would send empty vessels to India, but empty vessels break on high sea. So they would load the ship with salt, and the salt would be disembarked in Calcutta. So Carr and Tagore was a company that was formed to recycle that salt. And that's how money was made. Today we would call it enterprise. Today we would call it innovation. Today we would call it a great idea. But what we do is that we accuse Tagore and the Tagore family of being collaborators. Comprador bourgeoisie, the term which was invented by the left, by the communists. So we have somewhere along the line started using their ideas. We have somewhere along the line started borrowing their concepts. And we have even started quoting books which have been written by the original communists and saying that, you know, look, this is how it is. Unfortunately, on Bankim too, we have not been able to promote his fundamental book, Anandamot. We have had, this is the third government we have, but we have not been able to even explain to the people what the book was about. The book is not about Muslims. The book is not about hating Muslims. The book was written in the context of the Fakir Sanyasi rebellion. After the Battle of Buxar, the East India Company had imposed a tax, a pilgrimage tax. And the Fakirs and the Sanyasis of that time, they rose in revolt. And there was and Anandamot actually talks about it. The immediate context of the book is the famine in Bengal. It was a devastating famine. But nobody even puts out these basic facts. You have got AIR, you have got Doordarshan, you have got PIB, you have got Publications Division. The communists hated Tagore. So they put out this atrocious, outrageous lie that Jan Gan Man was composed to honor King George V. We don't even know that actually it is a six stanza composition. It's a song. It was a song which was part of the Brahmo liturgy. It accidentally was performed at the Congress session in Calcutta. Had Tagore not been asked to come up with a composition, it would not have been sung over there. We have not even bothered to check the full text of the song. In a way, I'm glad we haven't, because it talks of adoring God. He talks about band of brothers. I'm sorry, my brothers and sisters would have probably found the national anthem objectionable to had they actually bothered to read the full text. A couple of more points. On Tagore again. Oh, Tagore, look how Tagore derided nationalism. At least listen to Tagore. Tagore wrote about European nationalism that led to the First World War. Tagore didn't write about cultural nationalism. Tagore wrote about a forged nationalism in Europe where nations were invented and then nationalism was created around them. the Indian nation was not invented, nor, again, Tagore, when he writes about idea of India. Who wrote that book, Idea of India? Okay. Sunil Kildani. He didn't invent that term. It was Tagore who used it. So nobody says that Tagore wrote about nationalism in the context of the First World War. And subsequently, if you read Tagore's writings after that, he becomes a worshipper of this land, of this country, of its water, of its fields, of its crops, of its harvest, of the fruit it produces. If you go through the English translation of Tagore's composition, which is now the national anthem of Bangladesh, he worships everything that grows in this country. Lastly, on tiger hunting, somebody mentioned tiger hunting. More tigers were actually killed between 1947 and 1965 when Nehru actively promoted the idea of tourism through tiger hunting. There are ads which exist. And Air India used to offer a discounted ticket if you bought into that tiger hunting package. On fundamentalism and fanaticism, the two terms, there's nothing wrong in being a fundamentalist. As a scientist, Anand is a fundamentalist in the sense he believes in the fundamentals of science. Problem begins when Anand becomes a fanatic and tries to impose his interpretation of science on me. So as a fundamentalist, I would not go beyond my own religious tenets. I would not go and matha teko in a church or a masjid or somewhere, or in a temple for that matter, because my narrow faith tells me not to. But if I tell you and if I try to stop you from doing that, that is when I become a fanatic. I mean, it's a very simplistic explanation I'm offering. We could go on discussing this for hours. So there is no shame in being a fundamentalist. If somebody says, oh, you are a fundamentalist, of course I'm a fundamentalist. I believe in the fundamentals of my value system, my political thought process, my ideology, or whatever. And lastly, what can we do? We can do a lot. I tend to be political. I think with a government in power, we can do a lot. A lot more, a lot more than has been done in pushing ideas, in pushing our worldview as chairman of the Raja Ram Mohan Roy Library Foundation. I have resolved that I shall spend all the crores that we get as grant to populate libraries with books like this.
Thank you, sir.
So, unfortunately, the previous 6 years we were populating libraries with books by noted historian,
eminent
historian. I will not take his name. So thank you, Hari, for inviting me. It was very cold this morning, but
thank you
for you. Thanks.
You'll have to be. We are running out of time, so you'll have to be quite quick.
Absolutely. No.
The whole idea was not to get you, give you a chance.
Okay, one anecdote and one comment. The anecdote also contains an amazing coincidence. The coincidence happened just 10 minutes ago. when we were starting Swarajya, and I mentioned Swarajya because several of us here are or were associated with Swarajya. I was the first editor. Jerry was on the editorial advisory board. Sita was one of the first people working for Swarajya. Hari was the, and remains the friend, guide, philosopher, babysitter, and rainmaker, and slave driver, whatever. So when, just before Swarajya magazine was being launched in January 2015, I was interviewed by the Hindu. They gave half a page of the editorial page to my interview, and they carried the full interview, 6,000 words of it, on their website. This was completely unprecedented in the Hindu's history, promoting a media product. Nobody in media promotes another media product. To give it space on the editorial page, to carry a long interview, etc. Plus, a media product that was completely ideologically, philosophically anti the leftist stance of the Hindu. And the first question I was asked in the interview by the Hindu reporter was, so you're about to launch Sri Rajagopalachari's conservative magazine. And my answer was, look, the word conservative has a lot of connotations in India, social connotations, which have to do with orthodoxy, like gender equality, caste, etc. So I would rather avoid that word and say we are a right-of-center classical liberal magazine, which Kanchan mentioned just now. So I was wary of the word conservative. In fact, when I saw the title of Jerry's book some months back, that was the first thing I was reminded of. Now, whether by giving me so much space and promoting Swarajya's launch, Hindu was being liberal, conservative, or orthodox is a question, because I think they were promoting it because Sri Rajagopalachari was like the Hindu family, an Iyengar. I think that may have been a good reason. Would that be conservative or orthodox? The comment I want to make, Jerry, you have written about the cultural, economic, political, and educational aesthetic spheres of conservatism. See, there's also a moral sphere, and you spoke about it and talked about Adam Smith's book on moral sentiments. There's this concept called moral capital, like financial capital, social capital, etc. Broadly, I think it can be defined by the degree to which a community possesses values, virtues, practices, identities, institutions, technologies that mesh well with the with evolved psychologies that suppress or regulate selfishness and allow cooperation within communities. Some core values a community or a society or a nation needs to survive. I think moral capital, which is extremely necessary for long-term survival of a society or a nation or a religion or anything, is a blind spot of the left, because the liberals or the left, they sometimes overreach, try to change things too fast, and inadvertently end up eroding that moral capital very fast. That is why many liberal reforms fail, and many, almost all communist regimes become despotic. Now, moral capital, I don't think, is an unalloyed good, because cults and fascist regimes will also have high moral capital as long as a large majority of the people believe in those values. Hitler's Germany would certainly have had very high moral capital. Al-Qaeda would have had very high moral capital because everybody believed in that. But I think liberals erode that moral capital because they move too fast. Conservatives conserve that moral capital, but the problem with conservatives may be that in preserving that, they may overlook certain victim groups or certain groups that are benefiting or have been benefiting over the ages beyond their quote-unquote what is right for them. or they don't change institutions that should have been changed quickly enough. So I'm just introducing this concept of moral capital. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you. ECA.
I was hoping not to say anything, but we agreed on that. Very quickly, it's not very clear to me whether we are discussing your book or we are discussing conservatism in general. I'll stick to the latter, and perhaps when you bring out a new edition, you might be able to take care of this 5 or 6 points in a para or two here and there. One problem in this kind of discussion, book or whatever, is what is known as confirmation bias. So you look for things that you agree with, so in order to prove a point. So that should be avoided, because there is always an opposite view. The other thing is that, talking of the Indian context, back in 1988, I think it was, that A.K. Ramanujam, the poet, Chicago, he published an essay which was brought out in a book by a sociologist called Robert Linden. And Ramanujam's essay was called, Is There an Indian Way of Thinking? So when he starts off by writing that sentence, Is There an Indian Way of Thinking? He writes a couple of lines. And then he goes, Is there an Indian way of thinking? 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 And lastly, is there an Indian way of thinking? The emphasis becomes very important. And it's a long, wonderful essay. Essentially, his point is that everything depends on the context. And whether it's moral or anything else, economic, whatever, the context has to be kept in view, and the importance of context in Hindu philosophy. So you have the Bhagavad Gita, which says you can kill your brother, and the Gita also says quite the opposite in other places. So what is your concept of duty, brother? I want to get into that, but point is context. So it might be a good idea to insulate the book from both the confirmation bias problem and the Ramanujam issue of context. The third thing is that, and this is not about the book, this is about conservative thought or whatever it is, what you call it. This is something which I've been writing about for a few years now. Essentially, the idea came to me from the economics idea of the trilemma of interest rates, foreign exchange, and open economies. For a government, any government, it doesn't matter which government, left, right, center, whatever, there is, the trilemma is, how do you balance on the basis of some preconceived notions, left or right, between justice, equity, and efficiency. This is an extremely hard thing to solve, probably impossible to solve. Maybe it is impossible to solve because of the way I'm formulating it as being three. Mathematically, anything that involves three variables becomes practically impossible to solve. It's a very unstable system. Anything that involves three. But it's worth looking at how does conservative or liberal or non-liberal or left-wing thought, etc., square this triangle. You might want to take a look at that. There's then the question of, which follows from this, which is the question of what does conservative thought or liberal thought or whatever, how does it deal with the issue of the individual and the group? Now, there is a whole stream which will focus on the individual. Certainly the Europeans have made the European, modern Europeans have made the individual the unit of social action and government action, and which is, as we were discussing earlier, which is why Netherlands now has a problem. Netherlands views individual Muslim migrants as individuals. The Muslim migrants themselves don't view themselves as individuals. So there's some sort of tension or whatever you want to call it. But what does a state do? What does conservative thought say about how to treat individuals and how to treat groups? And depending on where the balance lies, certainly left-wing thought has no time for individuals. It's all about groups. So that's the other thing. Again, a related thing is, you know, I find this is a bit of a bee in my bonnet, but I find that in most social science discussions, we don't acknowledge or even refer to concepts in mathematics which have dealt with very similar problems. And I'll just name one here, but there are many. I mean, this three thing is, it's a problem from mathematics, really. You know, when Sukumar Chakravarti, you mentioned as a bit of a bounder, which he wasn't, he used to teach us in Delhi School of Economics, and one of the classes or three courses, three lectures he took was on something called the geodesic problem, which is really the economic problem it was trying to solve was, how do you get from point A to point B in the quickest time? Now, if it's a plane, you get to it, it's a straight line, there's no problem. But what if it's a curved surface? And the curved surface is what society, governments, political parties, all of them have to deal with. And sometimes if you use these concepts, the rigor of analysis becomes more pronounced, because then the kind of logic that is used, that has to be spelled out. And the final point is, really there's no other way of putting it, where does conservative thought stand in respect of the use of coercion to achieve certain goals? In every religion, religion by practically by definition is coercive. It prescribes punishments or whatever you want to call it if you don't fall in line. Stalinism, the Soviet brand of communism, is also the same. What we don't realize in India, or at least in many countries probably, is that the American system is equally coercive. The instrument, the agency which is using that coercion may not be the central government or the state government or any government agency. It might simply be social coercion or whatever it is. But coercion is very much a part of the US way of getting things done. To achieve a particular end. Last sentence, the reason why Europe is falling apart is because it's forgotten that coercion is a necessary concomitant of achieving goals. You can't just tell everybody, okay, you drive the way you want to, you become like roads in India. So I'll stop there. Thank you. Wonderful book, because this really needed to get written. As he said, where do I hang my coat? And this is a good place to hang it. Thank you.
Thank you. Shakti?
Thank you. Both of us are to be at North Delhi at 12:30. But we'll leave that aside for a moment. Start with what you ended with. I think the book needed to be written. We're glad you've done that. It is extremely comprehensive, extremely universal. That doesn't, of course, mean that you subscribe to everything. And there's something that I thought I'll just raise here. One, the context is very important. Why is the context important? I mean, Hitler, we mentioned. Hitler's party was called the National Social Party, Socialist Party, right? They made highways. They controlled the economy, People's Car, Volkswagen. They controlled the economy. If that is not left, I don't know what left is. But Hitler is seen on the right. As in Osama bin Laden and this, what Saeed fellow? Taibe Lashkar-e-Taiba. Right? I mean, where does right come in? I don't understand that, you know, in any sense of the term. Even with the Islamic context, they're not upholding the status quo. They're actually being radical within Islam. So how do you call them right? I don't understand that. And which is why, I know, we should learn from the others, absolutely. But I do find it not very easy to see the relevance, complete relevance, they are relevant, of course, Western conservatism to the Indian context. Since Western conservatism, as Scruton also tells us, is very firmly rooted in the Judeo-Christian milieu, anchored in the Westphalian state as it developed, despite the EU. And what did the Westphalian develop into? One nation, one state, one people, one religion, one language. The French converted the area south of Lyon, which didn't speak French, into French-speaking in less than 50 years. They were clear one language, you know? The question then is, what is Indian conservatism? Is there anything to conserve in a society that is unequal, has seen tremendous oppressive social systems, and still very poor? Do conservatives believe in the status quo? And what are the economic and political implications, which you've handled really well, I really liked it. And I would argue that Indian conservatism is about all that is good in our culture, our traditions, and our institutions. And this is where I disagree now with some of what you have written, what Kanchan has said, and others. The easiest way to destroy a society is to make it forget its collective memories and its historical experience. These experiences are real and tangible and not imagined, as Benedict Anderson thought. Proselytizing religions and colonial masters sought and seek to wipe out all evidences of a prior culture by burning libraries, books, demolishing temples and statues, and banning social customs. Some of it needed to be banned, fine, but not everything. Because unfortunately for them and fortunately for us, we have retained sufficient knowledge and insights from even our prehistory to claim that its traditions and epics are living realities for us. They are not dead knowledge boxed in museums and its books, as in, say, Greece, for example. The best proof of the living nature is that Indians, faced with colonialism and modernity, did not have to create an Indian nation. It was already there. A nation need not be conflated with a nation state, which for Indians is a new phenomena. We have to accept that. In any case, the Indian nation state established itself very firmly in a very short while. Why? Since its fundamentals, Kanchan, were widely accepted. This is very different from elsewhere. For example, in the 19th century, it was Italian nationalism that created the Italian nation. In contrast, it was the Indian nation, in response to colonial rule and lack of agency, that created Indian nationalism. The argument about prior existence of the Indian nation can be elaborated, but I leave it aside for the moment. Sufficient to note that the lack of common political space historically did not come in the way of a common identity of India. This should, of course, not mean that we love to be self-satisfied and we need no change and we don't like criticism. That is completely bullshit. That we have to critique discussions, building up consensus, arguments, in that sense, is what conservatism is about. Because change is incremental and not revolutionary. I'll not go to my revolutionary change is bad for the very people, because elite retain power and the others lose out in any case, in any violent revolution. So let me end by quickly saying that a question that we arise should be is, how is Indian conservatism different from classical liberalism? And I would say that unlike liberalism, conservatism is not just about the individual, but takes into account society too. Unlike the West, it is not about only society with no value on the individual. One dead is a tragedy, 100 million dead is the statistics, Stalin. It's not about that. We seek to balance the two, the individual and the community. And we seek to achieve it slowly. Historically, we have sought to balance community wisdom and individual choice because we do not see a contradiction between them. The moment you posit a contradiction, then we run into trouble. If it is tiger versus man, the tiger loses. How do you reconcile this? And I think our biggest strength is the lack of a definitive dogma allows for accommodation because we accept that none of us have the monopoly of truth. Thank you very much.
Let me now invite the last speaker, Rahul, to speak.
Thank you, Hari, for remembering me to discuss this book. And I must say, at least till the social sphere, I have read it thoroughly. But I will not comment on everything. I will definitely write back to you. This is certainly a very, I must say, a bold book. Especially the conscious Babs that you mentioned about, the liberal, Marxist, and Freudians. They are really, you know, important from Indian point of view. And I would like to, you know, as Kanchanda started, you know, disclosures from the references from the books, from this particular book, I completely, you know, associate myself with your idea of conservatism, where you say change is needed to conserve the best in our past. I'm of that. But at the same time, I'm not Hobbesian, as you said. I'm more with Rousseau. In your words, I'm certainly anti-Macaulay Putra. I'm a Hindu extremist from your analysis point of view. And still I'm a conservative, and this all thing can be together. And that is Indian, that is what you have discussed in your cultural diversity. That can coexist at one place. And there I find a problem with your political sphere, where you essentially believe that this unity project was a British project. Because, you know, I am damn sure that, you know, when it comes to understanding India, I'm not saying that, you know, even present-day Marxists, for example, I wouldn't call them anti-national. Their understanding of India is non-Indian. They are imposing essentially non-Indian categories to India, and there, Marx, Mill, or Macaulay, they fall in the same line. And in fact, if you are talking about Macaulay, and if you are not talking about Trevelyan, for example, who's spoke about you know, the need of English education in India, then you are doing a grave injustice to entire analysis, because his project of entire English education project was not about either unification or creating institution. It was basically about proselytization. So there I think somewhere, you know, but I find this important, this book, because I think you are clear about the audience. You have not written just for this audience. You have written this for the audience who understand this very English terminology to explain the realities of Indian conservatism. And therefore it becomes important. There are three, four quick points that I will mention, because I know we are short of time. One at factual level, because I'm another identity that I must disclose, a proud Sanghi. I'm editor of Organizer, so I can't escape that. But neither Hedgewar nor Golwalkar ever be a member of Hindu Mahasabha. So factually that is wrong. Even after formation of RSS, Hedgewar continued to be a Tilak group member of Congress. And in 31, he in fact joined Gandhi's Satyagraha, in fact giving away his position of Sarasanga Chalak. At one place, you have clearly mentioned this, that they left Hindu Mahasabha and formed RSS. So I, you know, factually that is a very problematic thing. I don't have much of a problem with the first, you know, your title, because you have defended that very well. I have more problem with the subtitle, The History of Right Wing. In fact, one of the first pamphlets that I, another disclosure coming from JNU, you know, one of the first pamphlets that I wrote was titled as I'm Left, Am I Right? And I argued that who are you to call yourself left? you are the most status quo people. You are not allowing anybody to speak. You are not allowing, you know, contrary ideas to flourish. So this, and the problem lies in, again, getting into this trap of binaries. And somewhere in political sphere, I afraid, somewhere, either conservative or radical, that kind of binary you somewhere, you know, get into. And therefore, you are missing two important figures even in analysis, though in later in some references they come. One is, of course, Tagore. And Tagore's most important text, as Kanchanda referred and communists conveniently missed out, is actually his original speech, and then he developed as a book called Swadeshi Samaj. It's important to understand the Indian social reality, Hindu-Muslim relationship, caste equations, as well as the role of state and the importance of society. In all these aspects, you know, he has dealt with that. Why I called myself Hindu extremist? Because you have, developed a very important critique about that, and you mentioned that about, as many of the people mentioned here. Hindu becoming extremist is always good. Because on the extreme, he will be most docile, most accommodative, most. So, you know, in that sense, Gandhi was a Hindu extremist. But, point about this, you know, talking about Bajrang Dal or even the later part of Savarkar you were mentioned about as the reactionary thing. I agree. Post 1906, it was a British project to tell Congress that unless you bring these two communities together, there is no consideration of representation, and Congress accepted it as a, you know, fundamental project. That became a problem, in fact. If it would have been a natural post 1857 project, as Savarkar discussed, it would have been a, you know, clear-cut evolution. Then Hindu revivalism and Hindu restoration you discussed about. You said, you know, most of the things we settled post-independence, and was it really needed? You, in fact, raised this question, is it really needed? But in your cultural sphere, actually, you are emphasizing that is somewhere needed. In political sphere, you question that. So there, I again find a contradiction. Pakistan as a buffer state, again, I have a lot of problems, but we can discuss that later. The most fascinating part of your book is actually, in fact, which I started with, is the guide for further reading. And that is the most important thing that you have given to us. Because if you start with that, then perhaps you understand your, one would understand your book better. So again, I congratulate you for this bold, and very, very pragmatic kind of effort. I'm not definitely a conservative of, Amartya Sen kind, which you have identified as, Rahul rightly pointed out that there will be some problems regarding this. But it doesn't matter. Being a Hindu, I can, be very, very open to these ideas. On in economic sphere, I just have a suggestion if you can bring that in. Because you have specifically mentioned post 45, we have dropped our, share in the world, power, economic power by 50%. But I think we need to bring in somewhere, maybe Acharya Dharmapal here, or maybe a pre-British, what was happening in terms of, economics and, the trade, and what was that model? What can be preserved from that, and what can be recontextualized? And there, I think the relationship between the state and society. I'm definitely a, Swadeshi, but I'm not a, protectionist kind of. I don't want state intervention. I'm more a social entrepreneurship kind of model. With this disclosure, I'll stop here and I'll write back to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Rahulji. I think we'll have to bring it very quickly to a close because I know many of you have to leave. All I'll try to say here is that there is indeed there's a lot of different ideas on the Indian right, and that really comes together in this conversation and in his book. What I will do is maybe ask him for a few, very quickly, a few closing remarks, but I know there are several of you who really need to leave right now.
Thank you, Sanjeev, and thank you all for, I've taken some notes, and hopefully there will be an edition, a second edition, and we'll try and get this in. The subtitle was given by the publishers, full disclosure here. They felt that it would help the marketing of the book. In retrospect, I should have called it a survey rather than a history, because it is really very episodic the way I have written it. It's not written in a chronological style. I think, you know, Conrad, I have a view, and like him, I happen to be a practicing religious guy. I do my puja every day, and so on. I think the Anglo-Saxon connection was karmic. It was intended by the gods. I think Bonkim, in his own way, believed that. So there is that. We could have, you'd look at what the Portuguese left behind after 400, 500 years. Nothing. Feni, drink of Feni or something. Rubbish they left behind. Whereas our Indo-British encounter actually did produce something creative. And we can talk about this offline. I am very intrigued by this thing. Darwin, evolution, and is conservatism against the spirit of science? I will deal head on with this if there is a next edition. Islam, whether it can have a conservative tradition at all. Question, political tradition. Syed Ahmad Khan actually tried his best, I think. In some sense, I have a lot of time and respect for him. And for Arif Muhammad Khan today. These are tough. Theirs is a very tough situation to be in. It's much easier for a Hindu, because if your wife goes to Sai Baba temple, you don't really mind. You can continue to go to Tirupati, and I've mentioned that in my book. It's easier. It's tougher if you are born in a Abrahamic faith of recent vintage, not of old vintage like Judean or Christian, but relatively recent vintage. But nevertheless, there is scope for optimism, and I believe the Renaissance will come from India and Indonesia, not from any other Islamic country, certainly not from the Middle East. And in some sense, Naipaul anticipates this in his second book. Naipaul is a great guy. He anticipates so many things 20, 30 years before they happen. But it is a tough one. It's not obvious that it's going to happen. And I think that's a good question. Justice, equity, efficiency, I'll try and put them together. Is it all Judeo-Christian? Is it all one nation, the point, Scruton's point? I don't think so. I think great people, great ideas happen all over the world at different points in time. We can borrow, they can borrow. Our prime minister has promoted yoga. They're all doing yoga all over the place. So I don't see any big. And it's just amazing. I will end, because we have to end in exactly 2 minutes, with Tamil, to those of you who can follow Tamil. Urdundu Arvane Varvan, Matrellam Kaimukunda Pinsel. He who tills the land, he alone lives. The rest are mere camp followers. In this, if you go back and read Langland's Piers Plowman, which is a medieval English poem, there's almost a one-to-one correspondence on this idea about the plowman's importance. Of course, Thiruvalluvar has a greater thing than just plowman. He's talking about all productive economic activity as being important, and the tyrant state, which taxes, as being, therefore, should be seen as a bystander and not as a contributor to it. Thanks for this session. Thanks for all the inputs. I'm glad there's at least, I don't know how many of you remember, about 5-7 years ago, Ram Guha wrote an article in EPW where he basically said there are no conservative intellectuals in India. Caravan is, it would carry that kind of article. And we really have to say that is bullshit. You know, we just have to keep pushing back. I know that, who's the guy in America? Yeah?
Thomas Sowell.
No, the national editor, famous fellow who died.
Buckley,
William Buckley and so on. They created this space. Horowitz, I mean, enough people created this space, and in England, Scruton, Dagmare, they are creating this space, and we need to do that with vigor and push back. In fact, say you guys are the ones who are not intellectual. It's a tough one because they occupy all the chaired professorships in all the universities. They occupy everything.
It's true everywhere. They so
just,
that doesn't matter.
It's very tough, but because it's tough, we don't give up. We have to go at it, and I think it'll take time, but it'll have to be done.
Thank you very much. I mean, of course, the discussion today brought together what is the right thing, which is that the Indian right or conservative have this variety of thinking, and that's exactly why how it should be, in the sense that after all, the left tolerates all kinds of different things which are contradictory internally. As I said, from feminism to Islamism is accommodated on the left. The contradictions on the right actually are quite trivial almost in comparison. So I think that will be a great if you could take some of these ideas in to
sure.
this Indian conservative or whatever you wish to call the next book. And let me pass it over to Hari to bring the session to a close.
Thank you very much, everybody. Just wanted to talk to you about the book, that article that you were talking about, Ramchandra Guha, that is in April 2015. And that was I saw that cover and I was very shocked, and it sounded very patronizing and condescending towards us. And that's the basis on which Indic Academy was set up. Yeah. And I tell this everywhere, saying that I used the anger against Guha as an inspiration for Indic Academy. And the mission 2020 that we set about, saying that, you know, there should be 2020, we should have so many scholars and academics and public intellectuals, that drives us. So
Guha's son is a very deep student of Rajaji's works. So I'll put you in touch with him. So chip of the old block sometimes is better than the old block.
Thank you everybody. This has been a very interesting format and discussion. All of you have read the book and come back and given the feedback. Thank you. Thank you.